be seated. Clearly, I have a little something going on in the upper respiratory system today. So, if you think that's going to make the sermon shorter, I don't know. Teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Oh, that is every teacher's ideal moment. A student who comes wanting to know something, asking a question. Teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Those of you who are teachers, which I think is probably 98% of you, will recognize what a glorious thing it is when a student has that kind of hunger and thirst. What must I do to inherit eternal life? And so, Jesus, like the good rabbi that he is, the good teacher, lists off the list. The list of the commandments, the ones you've known, the ones you learned, the ones you memorized during confirmation. He lists all of them off, plus one that we're not sure where Mark got it. You shall not defraud. That was, you know, who knows? Who knows with Mark? Anyway, it's a real interesting thing to me. The student who comes is a rich man, as he is described. Now, right away, you and I are probably going to say, well, that's not us. That's not us. We're not the rich man. So it's going to be hard to get ourselves wrapped around. This lesson must be about somebody else who's a rich man or a rich woman or someone who's rich. When I was in seminary, my best friend, who was not a seminary student, she had a T-shirt that said, "Eat the rich." And I loved that T-shirt. I had one that said, "There is no Iowa." So I coveted her T-shirt, "Eat the rich." Because the rich were not me. Especially in seminary. And the rich are not you. You make your living, you pay your money out, you may be comfortable, but probably we're not talking about the kind of wealth that this man had. But then again, maybe you and I might want to take note of the fact that in terms of how the rest of the world lives and what their income is and how closely they are to not having enough to eat on a daily basis, not having a good water on a daily basis, not having all the things that we take for granted on a daily basis, you would realize we are rich. So that's one level we can say, hey, we are in this story. We are rich. We are the rich young man. But then there's the other dimension. And that's the dimension that we are probably much more one with this young guy than any of us would care to admit. So, in order to get at that, we have to listen to what Jesus says. Do you see in that whole list of commandments there? That's pretty much all the second table of the law. See, you're good Lutherans, you know that's second table of the law. The second table of the law. The first one's not there. The commandments that have to do with God and one's relationship with God and how to live with God, they're not there. Not there. Shall we review them? Does anybody want to show what they know? See, I have them written down just in case. The one about having no other gods. The one about keeping the Sabbath holy. The one about taking the name of the Lord of your God in vain. Those are missing. And yet one other is missing as well. Do you recognize which one is missing? Anybody want to? See, that one might be an easy one. Which one's missing? Coveting. Coveting. See, somebody, we were right there. I knew you knew it. Have you ever tried getting through a day, leaving God as the first and foremost thought and purpose for your entire day? Have you ever tried getting through, well, I should say, have you ever tried getting through a week keeping God first and foremost? Above family, above friends, above work, above the demands of the church. Yes, I said it. God, above the demands of the church, above the demands of community, above the demands of your own ego and your own self need for ascendancy over others. When that man came to Jesus, he didn't just come because he wanted to know something cerebral. He didn't come just wanting to know what to do, even though that was his question. He came with an emptiness inside himself. He came with a need to have this question answered. What must I do to inherit eternal life? The eternal life is, it is eluding me. I don't feel it every day. I don't know it every day. I'm not living it every day. I'm not even sure what it is every day. And when Jesus poses all those other commandments to him, he says, I've done all that. I've done all that. And Jesus poses it in order to bring out what else is missing, what is really missing. Is God first and foremost and central to your life every day? That's a question for us. We think it's true, but, you know, we're not always the most honest people about who we are to ourselves first and then to other people. Have you ever tried, and if you think that one's hard, have you ever tried to get through a day or, let's say, an hour without coveting? Really? Anybody? Not me. When I was living in Philadelphia, my name's Heidi Louise Williams. My neighbors across the street, they said, you know what? Now that you're using your middle name, Louise, as your first name, your middle name is I Want. Louise, I Want. Williams. Because I said it so often. You know, I want coveting. We don't even recognize that we do it. We think that's normal. Heck, our whole entire economy is based on it. Coveting. Wanting things that we do not have. So I think it's significant today that the commandments regarding the absolute and ultimate center of our lives and being God, that the commandment regarding worship and the holiness of the Sabbath, the centrality of sacrifice, the commandment regarding the appropriation of God's name for our own personal and self-centered purposes, and the commandment for desiring everything else other than God are the ones that are missing when Jesus talks to this rich young man. And so the rich young man, we might see ourselves there. He has done all the commandments that he can keep by himself. He has done all the commandments that he can do. But the ones that require a change of mind, the ones that require a change of heart, the ones that require a revamp, the ones that require renewal, restoration, repentance, and all the other re-words, those areas he has not done because he cannot do them. And neither can we. You lack one thing, Jesus says. Go, sell all you have and give it to the poor. You lack one thing. Put aside everything in your life that you rely and depend on, that you have worked hard to accomplish, whether it is the amount of money that you have, or whether it is the esteem that you have in the community, or whether it is the position that you have in the church, or whether it is your reputation in the community, everything that you have worked hard to establish and to define yourself as, and put it away. Give it away. Not just give it away just to get rid of it. Give it away for the sake of someone else who doesn't have. That is a radical message that Jesus says to this man. Not surprisingly, that the disciples, they are sitting there going, what the heck is happening here? For Jesus has disturbed the entire calculus of the ancient Near East's understanding of what wealth symbolizes. Wealth symbolizes God's favor. You got wealth because you done right. Gary, don't check my grammar. You got wealth because you done right. And Jesus said, nah. In the kingdom of God, in the dominion of God, give it up. It doesn't amount to anything anymore. Give it up. And we see the young man turn his back and walk away. Walk the other direction. Leave. Because he'd worked hard for those things. He spent a lifetime keeping the commandments. He spent a lifetime accumulating wealth. He spent a lifetime making his own stature in the community. And Jesus says, for the sake of God, for the sake of relationship with God, for the sake of the emptiness, the hole in your being, in your soul that you feel, for the sake of that, give it up and give it away. If we are like the rich young man up to this point, are we like the rich young man in this regard as well? Are we willing to lay down the things that we most firmly hold near and dear to us? Whether that is our reputation, whether that is our wealth, whether that is the way that we do things as a tradition in the church, whether that is the way that we think things should be done in the church for all time, beginning now and on. Whether, it doesn't matter what, are we like the young man in this too, and unable to lay it down? Because that is the challenge here. This is a question about, overall, who do you trust, and how much do you trust? Do you trust yourself, what you can do, what you can manage to bring together, to work together? Do you trust that in all things, or do you trust God? Do you trust God enough to lie down and say, change me. Change me. Make me the person you want me to be. That's a big old deal, isn't it? I personally, I don't know about you, I would rather dictate to God where I think I need to go and what I think I need to do and what I'm gifted for. And, right? Wouldn't you rather do that? Wouldn't you rather tell everybody else how they're supposed to live too? We don't know each other very long, but I'm going to work on that. That's the challenge of the gospel lesson for this morning. Are we the rich young man? Will we turn away and go away sad? Or will we trust? Now the truth is, the gospel says, you're going to turn away. That's what the gospel says. That's what the gospel says to that man. And that's the point at which most of us say, well, then we've just got to work harder. We've just got to try harder not to turn away. We've just got to, Here's what the nature of trust in God is. And it doesn't have to do with our will. It has to do with God and who God is. God can change anyone, anything, all things, everyone. And he can do it without your help. I was a kid. No, I wasn't a kid. I was in my 40s. When you're in your 60s, doesn't it feel like 40s as a kid? It does. My mama, this is something you'll get to know about me. My brother and I were 10 years apart. He's 10 years older. He's a jerk. He really is. And I'm sure he'd say the same about me. We have spent a lifetime, 63 years to be exact, of sibling rivalry with me going to Mama and saying, Mama, you can't believe what David did last night. You can't believe what David said. Even in my 40s, I swear I was. I went to my mother and I said, Mom, David, I won't even remember what it was, but I was telling on him. And I said, he won't ever change. It's always going to be like this. I don't know why I have to put up with it. Blah, 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 blah. And if only, Mom, if you would just do this, he would. My mom just stopped me right there. She said, Heidi, you do not have to tell me about my son. I know my son. And I also know that he isn't going to change or is not likely to. But God can change. God can change anyone. Now, I'm still wrestling with my sibling rivalry. But every time I hear my own voice come up and say, Mama, Davey, I hear that. God can change everything. God can change you. As recalcitrant as you want to be, as set in your ways as you want to be, as much a slave to whatever it is you're a slave to, whether that is, tradition or whether it's desire or whether it's adultery or whether it's good stuff. You know, very often we're slaves to the good stuff. We're slaves to our own ideas about what the best thing is that ought to happen here and push other people away because I know what we should be doing. God can change even you and the situation in which you and I find ourselves. Yes, the call is to lay it down, to give it up, and to give it away. And I think you and I think we wouldn't be sitting in the pews here if we didn't believe that that's the call impinging on us as well. But I think we would also not be sitting in these pews here if we didn't realize that we ain't no good at it. And that we rely on God to change us. And now that means taking that thought, that trust, that everything out that door and living it out there in the narthex and living it out there down there at the Sunday school and living it out there at your house with your neighbor and living it out there at the grocery store and living it out there with all those other people who don't have as good ideas as us or living it out there. One last thought this morning. And that thought is, that thought comes from a young woman whose name was Betty Scott Stamm. She was a young woman who was the daughter of missionaries to China. And she also then became a missionary to China. She married a man who was in the mission field as well, and they went back to China. when she was 18 years old, she wrote a prayer. That happened to be in a collection of prayers that my mother gave to me when I was a teenager. My mother's always trying to make me a Christian. Not sure it ever happened, but she was always trying, and she gave me that little book. And that little book, for some odd reason, I actually read it. And this little poem was in there, and it was so meaningful to me. I need to know about Betty Scott Stamm because when she went back to China, she went back to China in 1931, the beginnings of the revolution, the Chinese. Revolution. And in 1934, her village was overrun. Her husband and her village was overrun by the Chinese communists at that time. And her husband was beheaded. And she fell down beside him, and the communists then beheaded her as well. And they left a little child sitting in the ditch, their little child. And a Chinese pastor came along and picked that child up and went on and returned her to the family. And Betty Scott Stam was 28 years old at the time, a life hardly lived yet. Here's the prayer she prayed, and I want you to pray it with me. So I'm going to ask you, just repeat after me. Lord, I give up all my own plans and purposes, all my own desires and hopes, and accept your will for my life. I give myself, my life, my all utterly to you, to be yours forever. Fill me and seal me with your Holy Spirit. Use me as you want. Send me where you want. Work out your whole will in my life at any cost, now and forever. Amen. May God grant that that be you and me. By God's grace,